Today, we're going to start our adventures in COBOL. Wait, adventures in COBOL? Is that even possible? Hey gang, how the heck are you doing? John Lotshaw, Crackpot Computing here, and welcome to Crackpot Computing's Retrocoding, Adventures in COBOL. We're going to take a look at how to program using COBOL, the Common Business-Oriented Language. You'll see why it is still one of the most used computer languages out there, and why it's deserving of a little respect. Something to keep in mind when you're about to make a joke comparing COBOL to the cast members of Jurassic Park. For the 10,000th time. The word COBOL is an acronym created from Common Business Oriented Language. It was designed to create a language suited to writing applications that could automate business processes, having been created in the days of batch processing and punch cards. It was created when the United States Department of Defense created CODASIL, or the Conference on Data System Languages. The Department of Defense convened CODASIL in 1959 to standardize programming languages among the various vendors they were buying computers from. You see, at that time, each manufacturer, like IBM or Remington Rand, had their own proprietary computer languages that ran only on their computers. Code written for an IBM system couldn't be ported over to a UNIVAC computer, for example, not without it being rewritten from the ground up. If the Defense Department could standardize development environments, well, it would eliminate a lot of duplication and save a lot of money. Because we all know how frugal the United States Department of Defense is. Now, you'd be forgiven for thinking that the U.S. military was an odd choice to be the impetus for a business-oriented language. After all, when you think of computers and the military, targeting systems and battlefield management computers come to mind, not accounting software. However, Uncle Sam is one of the largest employers in the world, with over 1.8 million men and women in uniform and almost a million civilian employees on every continent. You take all of the administrative record keeping that's got to be done for that, and then add in the massive inventory of everything from paperclips to nuclear weapons, and the logistical and accounting needs of the Department of Defense becomes mind-numbing and astronomical in scale. So the fact that the Defense Department is not only one of the world's largest purchasers of computers, but it's also one of the largest software development outfits on the planet, made it ideal for specifying and requiring a standardization effort among computer vendors. And that's exactly what they did. The CODASIL report, which was released in April of 1960, defined the COBOL language. It drew heavily from the work of Grace Murray Hopper, who in addition to being one of the world's foremost experts on computer software, was also at the time commander in the US Navy. The committee extended a language that she had been developing called Flowmatic and used elements from an IBM language called Comtran. Grace Hopper had a fascinating career. Among her accomplishments were writing the world's first high-level compiler, as well as devising tests that the National Institute of Standards uses to certify computer languages. She retired from the Navy in 1986 as the oldest officer on active duty with the rank of Rear Admiral, and she has an Arleigh Burke-class destroyer, the USS Hopper, named for her, one of the few U.S. Navy ships named for a woman. COBOL was meant to be self-documenting. Using an English-like syntax, it was meant to be understandable just by looking at the source code. Non-programmers, like managers, could comprehend what the computer is doing by following the code in very close to natural language. And herein lies one of the two biggest criticisms of COBOL. It's verbose. COBOL relies on so-called syntactic sugar, wording that doesn't serve to directly specify the operations the computer needs to carry out, but are there to make things more human readable. For example, let's say we have two variables, x and y. We want to add them together and store them in a third variable, which we'll call z. In many languages, this would be accomplished with a statement like this. But in COBOL, you would accomplish it with this. That's what's meant by syntactic sugar. And this is a simple example. Check this one out. Yikes. Just yikes. As complicated as that is, it is nothing compared to the biggest sin that COBOL commits, the go-to. This innocuous little statement, which causes program execution to jump unconditionally throughout the program, never to return, can cause even the simplest of programs to mutate into a steaming pile of tangled, twisted cyber pasta. Go-to is the root of evil from which all spaghetti code springs. Now, to be fair, this reputation for go-tos jumping program execution everywhere in your code like a 5-year-old that's inhaled 20 pounds of raw sugar was earned with earlier versions of COBOL, namely COBOL 60, 68, and 74. COBOL 85 and later have the perform verb, which kind of works like a function or procedure call in languages like C or Pascal. Still, first impressions last a lifetime, and COBOL's early reliance on GoTo gives it the unfair reputation of being a language that encourages sloppy programming practices. So what's the purpose in messing with a 60-year-old computer language? There's one simple reason. COBOL runs the world. Perform any financial transaction. Swipe a credit card, check your balance at an ATM, pay your taxes. You are, somewhere along the way, going to be using a program written in COBOL. When the COVID pandemic hit in 2020, the state of New Jersey put out an emergency call for COBOL programmers because the systems that handled unemployment payments was overwhelmed by demand, and they desperately needed COBOL slingers to sort out the mess. So what has led to COBOL's longevity? Well, COBOL works. It's as simple as that. Systems that run the banking and credit systems have had decades of uptime, and bugs have been found and eliminated. The code is very mature, and it's cheaper to have a COBOL compiler for the next generation of computers than it is to start over and introduce a whole new set of errors, ones that were probably fixed decades earlier in the COBOL version. Businesses can't afford to go back to square one with code that's been working reliably since the moon landing just because COBOL isn't cool. That's not to say that COBOL code isn't being replaced. The shortage of programmers who know the language and can maintain the systems is a very compelling reason to port these systems over to new languages. But there are billions, if not trillions, of lines of COBOL code out there, and it's not going to disappear overnight. As experienced COBOL slingers become more and more scarce, the salaries that can be commanded by someone who knows the language can only get higher and higher. After all, any kid watching YouTube can learn Node.js, but if Company X really needs a COBOL programmer to keep their business functioning, well, you can name your own price. I hope you found this brief look at COBOL interesting, and also hope that you'll join us for future episodes of Retrocoding's Adventures in COBOL. In the next episode, we're going to start examining the structure of a COBOL program and actually build a working executable from COBOL source code. So click the subscribe button and click the bell. That way you'll get notified when new episodes are released. And please don't forget to like the video. It really helps us get a leg up on YouTube's algorithm. So until next time, this is John Lotshaw for Crackpot Computing. Keep coding.